This podcast features adult content not suitable for listeners under the age of 18. You have been warned.
Hello, and welcome to this episode of Back to the Story, where friends come together to play Dungeons & Dragons. I'll be your DM, Klouse. Let's get started.
So we're going to go ahead and start, and I'm sure Roger will jump in here soon. But first, let's go ahead and start with our recap about the previous session, Chapter 5, Ophidian Peril, on the Knocked Mountain Range, Severwind, 15 to 16th Long Night. While looting, resting, and patching your wounds, you got to know a little about your new acquaintance, Wink, a deep gnome. Resting through the night without interference besides the sighting of a bird and large creature, the next morning you began to set out. Ball found tracks that led to a javelin trap, but continued to spite it. As the sun began to fall, you came to a high cliff. Ball climbed first, leaving the rope behind to help the rest of you up. Here, you all slept at the top of the cliff edge, Meli magically warding a large hole of some creature nearby. The next day, you continued through the forest, coming upon owlbear cubs playing at a frozen creek, lying eyes upon the mother, keeping substantial distance between you. Beyond, you traveled through the woods, inclining upwards until you heard a stampede of elk, followed by a hunter, and finally by a five-headed monstrosity, the Hydra. Most of the group ran, but with Wink hidden, nowhere in sight, Ball stayed to find him, allowing the Hydra to catch up. A one-sided fight began as the creature focused on Ball's large target. Ball invoked the power of Dronebol's axe to conjure a blinding blizzard, but death looked imminent. Before Wink was able to draw the creature away from Ball and the group and towards him, finding a boulder, Wink curled up as best he could, hiding from the Hydra, allowing the rest of the group to escape across a snowy field. Eventually, the group and Wink made their way to a cave, finding shelter, and the hunter, listening quietly for a few minutes in case the Hydra returned. Here, the air is cool outside of the cave as you all gather around, catching your breath, wrapping your minds around this journey and how far you've come to deliver this axe. You have to be getting close. Here in the small cave, towards the southern ridge of the Knock Mountain Range, the wind rushes by the cave as the sun begins its descent beyond the horizon, and probably an hour and a half before sunset. What would you like to do?
Well, I laid in the snow without a coat on for a little while, so if you all don't mind, maybe we just get a fire going and call it an early night. Near-death experiences are somewhat exhausting.
Might that attract the beast?
I don't think that the Hydra is anywhere nearby, at least for now. You see Kristoff speak up, the hunter, as he begins to set stones in a circle, pulling things out of his pouch.
Well, all right.
See, Kristoff begins to set up a fire. He sets it up, and then he begins to pull things out of his pack to set the fire, and he has a few pieces of small kindling, enough for a small fire, and begins to the tinderbox until it lights the flame.
I'm just patching Ball up best I can. And I don't think... At the end of last session, he said he went to shake all of our hands. Vesper did not shake his hand.
When that happened, he kind of still reached out near your hand and just kind of shaked his hand as a motion and then moved on to the next person.
So, Hunter guy, what was your name again?
My name is Kristoff von Wallenberg. He kind of smiles.
Right, Chris. So, how long... has that thing been, you know, just roaming the area?
Well, to my understanding, probably a long time. We don't normally hunt these woods, but the normal hunting area has been endangered, so I had to go beyond, which is out of the frying pan into the fire, so to speak.
What's wrong with the normal hunting area?
Well, you know, the typical problems of flying menace creatures swooping down, killing villagers.
Right.
It's always something.
Usual problem. What kind of flying creatures?
I'm not sure exactly what it is, but some sort of flying lion,
turkey?
Perhaps. I don't think this is related to the turkey, though. I am no bestiary expert, at least not of those sorts.
Great. Flying lion.
That ringing any bells?
For Kalvyn, you can make a nature check.
I love nature.
You get a special thing, advantage on intelligence checks when it pertains to certain types of creatures?
Correct.
Which ones? Which types?
Let me pull that up.
I think it's fiends, undead, but is it monstrosities?
No.
Okay, so it's just a straight check.
Nope. That is terrible. That suffices an 8.
An 8? I mean, there's griffins that are sort of lion, flying lion-esque type creatures, but besides those, nothing really springs to mind.
Yeah, flying lion's Vesper has perked up at that, but still doesn't really say anything.
But anyway, you know why I was here, to trap and hunt creatures, to make some coin, fur, find some meat. What are you doing here? As he scans this odd assortment, this big group.
Oh yeah, this is Ball's thing, so.
Yeah.
Well, we're on a delivery.
A delivery of what sort?
Honestly, I'm not really too sure anymore.
We have to bring an old axe to Jarl Womai.
You can see he kind of looks a bit shocked. Why? Exactly?
A favor for helping out, and I point over to Ball, for helping out our large friend over there. As repayment, basically.
I am no stranger to danger, but I am certainly not as brave as to march towards your Womai. Congratulations on being so brave.
I don't think it's bravery. We don't exactly know what we're walking into.
Yeah, it's more slight confusion mixed with ignorance that we go into this place.
Well, I do know much about that. Sometimes we get in over our heads. As you saw when I was running from the five-headed creature.
So, where is it that you're from exactly?
Von Wallenberg. I'm from Wallenberg. There's a small hamlet on the other side of the mountain.
How long have these, winged lion creatures been harassing your town?
It started about a month ago, and at first it was only one, but then they would come in pairs, and it has progressively gotten worse. We have had to be more careful when we are out, especially with the children. And they've also been striking at livestock and destroying crops. It has been difficult. But difficulty presents a challenge and opportunity, and I will be able to sell my meat and wares at a higher price. To, of course, help my village.
Noble.
Well, I didn't normally carry enough firewood to get a full fire started, just enough to get it going. I'm going to go find some wood. Be careful. Don't do anything stupid.
We're going to be staying here licking our wounds.
Good. And you see he kind of glances at his pack. And begins to leave it, but then he comes back and puts it on his shoulder and carries it out.
Is it a good idea for you to be heading out alone?
Well, I am not much of a fighter, but I am pretty good at keeping hidden. I think I'll be fine. But danke for the concern.
All right, Christoph.
He exits the cave, leaving you all in it. His ball is still kind of out of focus, just trying to patch up his wounds and get back to where he needs to be.
All right. Well, now that he's gone, I'm going to reach into my robe and I'm going to take off a patch. And I figured it's probably time that I actually hand these out. And the patch is a piece of fabric that has 4 vials on it. I conjure 4 potions of healing, and I give one to Kalvyn, to Ball, to Vesper and to Ellory. Sorry, Meli. I'm going to say, save these for when we're in combat. We're safe right now, and you can use spells and things. But if either I or Vesper cannot get to you, feel free to use this.
What is it exactly?
It is a regular potion of healing, so 2d4 plus 2.
Great. For the time being, how many of you need me to work my not-so-magic?
I just wave her away.
Great. Kalvyn? You looking rough at all?
I don't know.
Has anyone hurt?
Kalvyn's mostly okay.
Okay. So just me and Ball, looks like. Well, I make it for myself. I don't make the check for Ball, so when he gets here and wants to use some hit dice, he's going to have to just take what he can get.
I'm not so sure we should have told our new friend so much about what we were doing here.
Oh, well.
He seems harmless. A bit odd, but harmless.
Well, seems and is are not always the same thing.
Yeah. In my experience, not everybody can be out to kill you.
I don't think we gave him any significant details. Oh, we did, Jarl. God damn.
Yeah. Exactly.
Great job, Kalvyn.
Way to take. Don't try to throw this shit on me.
This one was squarely Amsen's fault.
I mean, what can I say? I'm a teller of tales.
Listen, that guy clearly knew some stuff, and we don't. So, if we can get something from anybody we run into, it's probably worth sharing a little bit.
I'm sure it'll be fine. He's trying to spend the night in here with us, assuming he trusts us enough to close his eyes around us. We're probably fine. Lord knows he couldn't kill us all in our sleep. By the third, someone definitely would hear screaming.
You're so cheerful and full of optimism.
Optimism might not be the right word, but sure.
Well, he clearly didn't trust us enough to leave his pack, but I don't really blame him for that.
Either way, we should probably keep watches tonight. Anyways.
Yes.
Have we done a thorough looking over of the cave? I feel like we did it last time, but I do want to be sure that we did.
I did a brief kind of look around when you first came in. It's not a huge cave. And you didn't notice any other exit points or where it went any deeper.
Okay.
You could attempt to look for something else if you're looking for something in particular, but it doesn't look to be like a extraordinarily deep.
Yeah, it was mostly just other holes that things might crawl out of.
No holes. There is snow on the ground where it's been whipped in, but most of the wind remains outside, providing a good shelter from the wind and snow outside. There's a little bit of moss on certain parts of the stones, but other than that, it's pretty blank in here. Pretty empty.
I'd like to take a peek outside and see if I can spot Kristoff anywhere.
Okay, you poke your head out, give me a perception check.
Oh, that's not good. 9.
You look around, you see the trees kind of swaying in the wind. You see the wind picking up a little bit of snow. You see the cloud coverage overhead. You don't see Kristoff. You do see a bird flying in the distance. As it passes by, you don't see anything else.
Well, I feel like we're all just waiting to have a conversation with someone who's not here.
Did y'all want to begin it's probably 5-ish, about an hour before sunsets.
Okay, I'm just going to start. If we got a fire, if we have any left, the orcs rations. I know that you said that was cookable last time. At least that's what I overheard. maybe start messing with that, trying to get some food in us.
Okay. For the night. Yes, you can. There's a little bit of a fire. It's not much, but it started. But you can begin to use that to cook what's the probably the last remaining rations of the orcs, as you'll use some before. Do you want to start a short rest? Is what it sounds like. Okay. So it'll take an hour to do that, but you can get some food in you, patch up your remaining wounds. Vesper can help those who she can, as you'll patch up your wounds, roll some hit dice. And about an hour later, as the sun is kind of setting, you hear a, after you patch yourselves up and get some food in, you hear a like the dragging of something through the snow. It continues in y'all's direction, slowly moving.
I'll go up Christoph? To the...
Yeah. Good job, Wink.
I'll just shout.
But
you need a hand?
Yeah, that would be nice.
Great. My 3'2" self will walk my ass out there.
I'll come and join them.
Okay, as Amsen and Wink come out, you see down the hill about 20, 25 feet, you see Christoph dragging what looks like the body of an elk up the hill, and you see on his back, sort of where a bedroll would be, you see a tied bundle of sticks, firewood, on his back as well. As he's dragging this elk.
All right, Amsen, we can handle the elk, right?
Possibly.
Well, it would be best if I can skin it out here and get it up on the tree here on this lower bench. That way, most of the blood is outside of the cave.
Sounds like a good idea.
All right. So you go over and you help him kind of lift it up. He has a hook that goes into both the ankle areas of the deer, and he wraps it around a branch, and y'all help him pull it up. Between the three of you, it's not a big task. Wrapping around to hold it up, and you see him pulls out a knife and begins cutting into the deer, harvesting meat, and looks like he's collecting the pelt as well. It'll take him a while to do that. If y'all want to do anything else while he's doing so,
when he strings up the deer, I'm gonna and right after he starts cutting into it, I'm gonna leave because it smells terrible.
Yeah, it does. Yeah, especially when he cuts the belly open, all the organs fall out. It's pretty gross. Wink, do you go too?
Yeah, I'm not. I don't care.
Inside the cave, I've just been pretty much pacing back and forth the whole time, glancing at Ball every once in a while, glaring at everything, being my usual cheerful self.
Is he down, or
no? He's conscious, but he's a little out of it. As you can imagine why.
He got knocked out unconscious like 3 times today, so.
Okay, so he's getting his beauty rest, more or less.
Yeah,
I think that's seems like the name of the game for the evening. Kalvyn finds a spot and rests up.
Okay, let you go to sleep, Kalvyn, or?
I mean, yeah, I doubt it's too early to start divvying out watches, so I'm going to catch sleep while I can.
Okay. So Kalvyn and Ball begin to sleep. About 30 minutes later, Wink and Amsen return. So does Christoph. He's carrying some meat wrapped up in a pelt that he harvested. And he uses the wood he collected to build the fire a little bit more, and he begins to cook some of the meat. It smells really good. He actually pulls out a small bowl of salt that he throws on there as well, and some of the meat. Begins to cook. He does offer it to anyone who wants to eat.
Thank you.
He's tearing into it. He quickly eats, and the rest of you can eat more if you want any. And before he kind of settles back in a corner as best he can in the cave, and just kind of keeps his crossbow on his lap, just kind of watching you all. He pulls out a little flask that he drinks every once in a while.
I think at some point I'm going to go sit kind of near him. With the crossbow that he's holding, I'm not going to sit too close. But I'd like to ask him So how far away is this village of yours?
Vattenberg is maybe 5-6 days from here. This is sort of nestled in the foothills there in the valley. So it is somewhat hard to get to, which is good. Except when creatures fly.
Mm.
And you are? Where are you all from? He's trying to whisper, trying not to wake up Ball or Kalvyn.
Pretty sure that's directed at Ellory, if you want to. Just whenever you're ready, don't feel rushed.
We're from down in Embershore.
Ah, well, I've done business there before. Perhaps I will again. Drinks a little bit more.
Ever been to the Copper Sail?
No, it's well, it's actually been quite a while since I've been there. But I will certainly stop by the Copper Sail if it is something you would recommend.
Oh, I can definitely recommend it.
He kind of squints at your eye grin, not sure what it means.
I can see that you all have had quite a day, and so have I, though maybe not to the same extent. But I will keep watch. As he takes one more sip of his flask and puts it away.
I'm actually feeling relatively okay, so if you want some company, Christoph, I'm up for it.
Well, if you would like to, that is completely up to you. I will not sleep tonight, as you understand. I just met you. But I will watch for you all, and you can stay up with me.
Of course.
And he offers the flask, actually, to you, if you would like to invite.
I will take a drink out of courtesy, but give it quickly give it back to him afterwards.
Okay, the little sip you get is like this thick substance. It's dark, this kind of black, brackish substance. You may have actually had it before. It's called basal black. It's actually produced in Embershore.
Ah, good. I know what that is.
This is one of my favorites. He takes it back. Takes one more sneaks, one more sips before puts it up. And kind of sits back to watch. For those who are staying up to watch, go ahead and roll a perception check. If it's just Amsen, you can go at advantage because Christoph's helping.
All right.
I was going to offer to take one shift if Amsen wants to sleep at some point.
Yeah, I would take a shift as well.
I can take one too if you want.
All right. So I'll do first watch with advantage because of Christoph.
Yeah.
Perception. That's a natural 20. So, you know.
Okay.
Natural 20, so 21.
Okay. With that natural 20, you'll watch for a good 1 hour. The second hour goes by. It's just kind of windy. Every now and then you hear maybe a distant howl or hoot of various creatures. Nothing really goes by until you kind of, you hear a, you hear something flying land just outside the cave. You hear, and you can see as you kind of bend over and around to look out of the mouth of the cave, you can see a bird. Large eagle with black feathers, yellowish golden talons and beak, and the two eyes are unnatural, glowing this kind of pale blue color, and they're just staring into the mouth of the cave. You can see Christoph kind of sees it too and kind of grips his crossbow a little stronger.
I'm gonna like keeping my eyes on the creature but kind of like glancing over at Christoph every now and then. Just kind of whisper over, what is it?
Well, it looks like an eagle with strange eyes.
You can see he's a little nervous.
I got a question. Does it kind of look like what Valrin looked like?
No, it doesn't have that same sort of feel. It looks more like just a golden eagle, but the eyes are almost glossed over. Very pale glow of blue. You notice the Valren and the Valgrith, when you did see it, both had green glowing eyes and horns. And this creature looks completely like a normal golden eagle, except for its eyes are pale blue.
Okay. Then I'll just be like, well, it's nothing sinister I've seen, but... And I'll just reach down for my hand crossbow and keep it in my lap at the ready.
Okay. And this kind of occurs at the end of your watch, and you wait a minute, 2 minutes, 5 minutes. It just is staying there. It doesn't move. It's just staring into the cavern.
Okay. When my shift ends, then I'll wake up Wink and let him know about the creature that's sitting in the trees just outside the cave.
Okay. Do you want me to shoot it?
Try to take a more defensive approach to it. More like if it attacks, then attack it. But, you know, it seems to be fine. It's been sitting there for the last few minutes.
Okay. I won't shoot it. Unless it shoots me. Got it.
And, okay, so...
I'll go to bed.
Okay, so Amsen goes to bed, Wink takes over. Wink, give me a perception check. At advantage, because Christoph is still awake, staying up.
I thought we were just all rolling, so it's already there. It's a 17.
Okay. An hour or 15 minutes goes by, you see the bird, it hasn't moved. Another 30 minutes go by, an hour goes by. An hour and a half goes by, and the bird is just staring in. Looking in one direction. It's not staring at you, but it is staring in one particular direction.
After about an hour of it, I'm going to get curious. So I'm going to go out of the cave and just kind of like wave up at it and see if there's any reaction.
As you walk outside and wave at it, the bird's head just kind of tilt down and sees the movement and then tilts back up to look into the cave.
Hello? Do you want me to get somebody?
The head turns back down towards you, kind of lifts up, swoops down, and lands about 5 feet in front of you.
Ooh, 5 feet
space between you. And it's probably a little taller than you, honestly. It's a pretty big eagle.
Good birdie. Good bird. Which one? Do you want to come in?
You can hear Christoph just saying no, 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 as the bird is just staring at you.
Blink twice if you want to kill me.
It takes a step forward towards the cave now, still looking at you. And we go ahead and make either a nature perception check or investigation, actually.
I will do investigation. So that's an 11.
Okay. From how close you are to this bird, especially now that it's beginning to take slow steps towards the cave, you can say it mostly looks like a normal bird, but you can see the shoulder has exposed bone and flesh. You can see the head, there's a mark across the side of its skull, where it looks like an old festered wound. You can actually see part of the skull beneath the wound as it takes another step.
I'm going to call out, Christoph, wake up the big one.
Okay. You hear some rumbling as Christoph kind of shakes Ball. Roger, are you there? Are you still listening?
I'm here. I'm listening.
Okay. As Ball, you've been sleeping and you feel shaking as Christoph, the hunter, is kind of shaking you. And he points out the mouth of the cave where you see Wink is standing, and then a creature a little taller and bigger than Wink's size. You see a big black eagle that's looking in towards the cave.
Hey, big guy, is this thing undead?
I'll kind of just rub my eyes and slowly... I think I'm still a bit labored, so I'll slowly get myself out of bed and get just as close as I need to get. To then use my divine sense.
Okay. Yeah, you get up and you just take, you only have to take maybe 5 feet forward. And yeah, it's undead.
I'll start to grip my sword and nod at Wink.
Okay. Just gonna slowly back up. Gonna slide my bow off my back.
The bird doesn't react when you walk backwards. But it does watch you as you're taking your bow out.
Look. If you go in there, they're probably going to kill you. So, if you don't want to die, go away.
You can see as the eyes are glowing, it kind of looks at you and looks back in towards the cave. It takes its claws and it lifts up one of its wings, and you can see there's some sort of leather on the underside of its left wings. And you see it kind of tilts over on its side to where it can grab with its talon. It uses his beak to loose something, and it drops something in the snow. You see the eyes suddenly shift. They change in color to where they're more palely, just barely glowing now, as the eagle flies off towards the southeast.
Okay, that was fucked up. What did he drop?
You see a little cylinder device of some sort. Some little canister, it looks like. About the size of a beer bottle.
Yeah, I'm going to grab it.
Okay. You grab it and you can see it looks like it's just a little wooden cylinder. It's like there's a seal in the middle where it can be pulled apart.
All right, I'll bring it back to the cave. So it's just me, Ball, and Kristoff who are awake right now, right?
Yeah, and you see Kristoff is nervous in the back holding the crossbow.
Any idea what this is?
What does it look like? It looks like a canister?
It looks like a cylinder wooden box, a small cylinder wooden box.
And it is able to be opened, hypothetically.
Mm-hmm.
I want to open it, but I feel like everybody's going to be real mad. I open the box.
Okay, something falls out of it onto the ground. You see a piece of paper that's rolled up, and you see holding it together into that roll, you see a seal of red wax. You see there's a symbol embedded into the seal.
Does the symbol mean anything to me?
Make a history check. Do you have history proficiency?
I do.
Okay. Yeah, you go ahead and make that. You can see 10. It looks like 10. Okay. It doesn't ring any bells. You can see it has two kind of reversed, like a C and a reverse C overlapping with three slash marks in the center connecting the three, but it doesn't, you have no idea what the symbol is.
Somebody has mail, and I'll throw it at Ball. You want the next watch? I'll just go to sleep.
Okay. Wink goes to sleep after throwing it to Ball.
All right. I guess the three times exhausted Ball will be up for watch. I guess I'll slowly walk over to...
Oh, right. No, I'll remember that. Okay. No, it's fine. He will remember. Go back to bed. I'll get... I don't know. I'll wake up the smoke lady. Oh, wait, no, she's the other one that got injured. Yeah. So... Oh, no, you didn't drop? Okay, never mind.
I'm good. I just got hurt. I didn't drop. Right.
Hi. Your friend's up. I'm gonna go to sleep.
How are you feeling, Ball?
There's a letter. And then I'll point to the letter on the ground.
Okay. I'll pick it up. Does this seal mean anything to me, who is proficient in history?
You can roll a history check.
Oh, that is a 22.
You've seen this symbol before. You can't remember exactly where, or where it was, but you do remember it was when you were at the tower, when you went with Kalvyn.
Mm-hmm. I'll go set it next to Kalvyn then.
Okay.
That's for him.
Okay, are you taking up the next watch then, Vesper?
Yeah, I look like I want to say something to Ball, and then I'm like, get some rest.
I'll slowly make my way back to bed. Doesn't take me too long to fall back asleep.
Yeah. And Vesper, go ahead and give me a perception check.
Ooh. All right. That is a perception. How perceptive am I? That's a 22 again.
Okay. Everything goes by normally. You hear the howls and hoots of wolves and owls outside occasionally. The only thing of note that you notice is a vibration you feel in the stone. It only lasted for like a minute or two. You just kind of feel a vibration on the ground. You put both your hands on there to feel it. You're going to feel it very distantly, very faintly. Then it goes away.
That's odd. Christoph, did you feel that?
You can see he kind of rubs his eyes. What?
Never mind.
He looks startled and kind of holds his crossbow again. He's halfway asleep and kind of pipes himself up.
You know, we're not going to cut your throat. You can go to sleep if you need to sleep.
That might be true. But he remains awake. But the rest of your watch, Vesper, goes on without issue.
I'll wake up Ellory for the next watch.
Okay.
And Ellery, I'll let her know about the vibration. I'd probably just sleep deprived, but, you know, just in case.
Okay. Good morning, I guess.
And Ellery, go ahead and give me a perception check. Just a straight roll. As Christoph is either, he looks half asleep, he's not.
Okay.
A whole lot of help.
Yeah, that's a 10.
Nothing piques your interest. Eventually, the sky outside changes into that blue just before sun rises as the golden sun begins to peek up over and warmth kind of begins to invade the cool morning. The rest of you awake to consciousness one by one. Though Ball seems to stay asleep longer than the rest of you. His wounds and everything else taking a toll on him. And for a moment, would you all, besides Ball, go ahead and mute your sound and speakers so that I can just deal with Ball for a moment? And I'll
don't
type
leave
in the chat
me. No,
when it's ready to come back. So I'll give you a few seconds to mute your sound and speakers as we will hop over to Ball. So, Ball, you come to sleep. You wake up again to sense the bird, and you fall back asleep, this time harder than before. And in your sleep, you feel a coolness on your back, like you're laying on ice. You hear a sort of wind whistling by. You open your eyes to stark whiteness as you look around to see a void of frost and ice, whipped up by snow. You can see you're on a coast, covered by ice and snow as far as you can see as you scan your eyes along the coastline, looking out to a sea, covered and shrouded in mist of ice and frost and snow and sleet. And as you do scan your eyes from the left to the right, your eyes stop upon a great glacier that is impaled into the side of the coast. Inclining up sharply, 20, 40, 60, 100 feet up, at the top of which you see a mountainous silhouette, at the top of which you see two pale glowing blue eyes. At the base of this glacier, you see a stick embedded into the ground, at the top of which is some ancient banner whose figure has long been faded. The banner whips in the wind. You hear it whoosh, as the banner rips in the wind from the stick and whoosh, is whipped and dragged up, gliding upwards towards the figure before disappearing in the snow. You see the silhouette shift, the shadows move, adjusting your vision as you see. You hear something reverberating, like mountains grinding against each other in the sky, a thunderous noise. In giant, In the tongue of giants, you hear these words.
Jungen child, hear my thum. The omens of the Allfather precede you, marked where black clouds loom. To the high sky you cry, but to weak gods you pray. In your heart lies power, in your hand lies the way.
Well, as you stand, you grip the axe. As you feel a sudden cold surge over it, you see the weapon covered in a layer of frost and ice as the giant continues.
Born from the mountain's marrow, moulded by blood of fire, thum's thunder, the breath of wind, defeat rouses your ire. Shed your burdens of worthless faith, in these gods you will not pray. Take up the axe of icy your tongue, the ordering of might will guide your way. They can break you, but not this promise. Even death wandering its toll, through the darkness you will find that in your axe still beats a soul.
And as you hear the last word ring in your ears, you see this figure stepping forth. Its footfalls dampened and quiet compared to the reverberation of its voice. You see this figure with a helm with four horns that curl upwards and back. You see two pale glowing eyes burning. You see this beard of white blue flowing. You see four braided knots that come down wisping in the wind as it steps forward. It bends its head down to you. Its nose about as big as your entire body. This creature of mass and strength as it looks at you. There's a sudden of wind as he gets closer to you, blinding you to nothing but void white. As you wake up in the cave, your back cold from the snow, as you come to consciousness once more. And let me get everyone to gather back around. And you guys just say something to let me know that you're back. Okay.
Good to go.
All right, as you are kind of coming to consciousness, preparing yourself for the morning, you can see even Christoph is kind of rubbing his eyes. You can see bags under them have formed as he tried to stay up the whole night. He may have made it. Finally, you look over to Ball, who's taking a while, sleeping in, but eventually kind of breathes in, come to consciousness, leaned up against the stones. He begins to stir. Morning is shed in a golden light. It's still cold, but the sunshine warms your skin as you prepare. What would you like to do?
How far away from Ustax are we?
You're guessing maybe 2 days?
So, unpopular idea, do we want to just rest here for the day and let Ball recover? Get more? We'll lose a day travel, but he'd be in better condition.
It's possible.
It's a fairly safe location. And he's not in great shape. And this is going to be incredibly dangerous. He rests up today, and he rests up tonight, and by the time we get there, he'll be in good condition.
Pretty sure that's his call.
Well, I'm sort of throwing it out to everybody.
I'm just saying, he gets to make that say.
I look over to Christoph. How dangerous is the area between here and Ustax?
Well, it is the worst. I would not try it. But you seem very brave, and good luck. There, you're going to see the Jarl. How are you going to get there? Are you going to march along the fjord, along the Sabre River? Have you gotten that far yet, in your minds?
You're implying we have a plan.
Well, I would never go here, but there is a way that is dangerous, but maybe not as dangerous as Trussing through patrols and the Orc Horde?
I'd be willing to hear that way.
Well, I've never been through it myself, but I've heard rumor of a pass along the ridge that keeps you on the southern edge of this range, so you do not enter into their territory, just staying out of it and cutting through a pass to go right up next to the fort. The name of this pass is Ogre's Breath Pass, and as you can imagine, there are probably ogres there. So it seems like a pick your poison. As Christoph is kind of gathering his stuff up.
That might be better than trying to take the more direct route through.
Great, but we're not sneaking in. We're not doing anything dangerous that's going to threaten them. Why should we?
You did hear what he said about patrols, right?
Yeah. If we're straightforward, though, maybe we can speak to the orcs, you guys, you and Kalvyn. I'm throwing ideas out. I'm not committed to anything. I'm just throwing out suggestions so we think about all of the facets of this.
I am going to go home, but I will tell you it is, and he gives you the directions as best he can to this other pass. He draws it in the snow, gives you an idea of about where it is. He does say, there is a pass here, but in that area, there's a lot of confusing passes and valleys and crags and gulches. So make sure you pick the right one. And he kind of shows you as best he can the right path. As he's packing up his gear and after he gets it all together, he begins to head out.
Well, good luck to you, Christoph.
Danke. That it was, I won't say a pleasure, but it was interesting. And he shakes your hands in that strange way where he kind of grabs the forearm. Anyone that will do it, if you aren't willing, he'll just skip you.
I'll shake his hand today.
He grabs it tight.
Christoph, our experience with you has been as interesting as your experience with us.
That I would take that as a compliment. And he kind of does a strange forward salute and marches off down the hill to the south.
So we're staying in this cave for a day, right?
That's my suggestion, but you don't have to take it.
Is Ball not awake?
Ball's come too.
Okay, it's his call.
Yeah,
I'm as he said, we're doing it.
Ball, how are you feeling?
Better.
Do you think you want to stay here and feel even better?
Or do you want to press on, get this done?
Do not know the best way to speak to the Jarl.
Here, let me ask this question, Ball. How are you feeling to move?
Klaus, I forgot. Exhaustion level 2 is what I should be at now. Is that half move as well? Or is that just at exhaustion 3?
Level 2 is disadvantage on checks and speed aft. But you got rid of disadvantage on attacks and saves.
Okay. I can fight, but I am slow.
Well, we'd rather not fight very much. We just need to travel. I think, for me personally, I'd rather wait until Ball's ready to travel too, and not just fight.
I agree.
That's 3 votes. Meli?
Yeah, I agree too.
Wink? Wink!
Wink's falling asleep again.
Alright, Kalvyn?
Huh?
You want to stay or do you want to go?
If Ball feels like he can move on. Actually, hold on a sec, I'm reading something.
Just pulls out a comic mid-talk.
You can see he's unrolled. I assume unrolled that parchment. And is reading it.
How did that get here, by the way?
No.
Must have been magic. I woke up and it was right next to me.
Well, crazy. I put it there.
What?
I don't know how it got to the cave.
That's...
Oh. I look to Ball and Twink.
What does it say? The magic spell?
I'm reading it. Hold on.
While Kalvyn's reading it, I'll look to Vesper and say, the dead bird brought it.
It. I also want you to know that it is an accomplishment for me to talk to a dead bird without shitting myself, so I hope you're happy.
I'm thrilled.
It was bigger than me.
I'm sure. It's not hard.
You talked to a dead bird.
Mm-hmm. And then it pulled the note out of some flap in its skin and flew away.
And what did it say?
Nothing. But didn't try and kill me. It left that note. I gave it to the big one. I don't really care.
One of your friends, Kalvyn?
Does Kalvyn know how to read? Like, what if he's just super struggling? And he just doesn't want to say anything, right? He's just like, oh, I'll just stare at this long enough and it'll make sense.
Yeah, it's a 3-sentence letter.
What up? My name's Kalvyn. I'm 19. I never fucking learned how to read.
I guess Kalvyn is having trouble reading it. Okay. He's engrossed.
He's got all day to read it because we're going to stay here. Majority rules.
Sorry, what now?
Anyway, was your dead bird letter important?
Actually, yeah, it kind of is.
Hold on, he's reading it.
Well, I don't see any, like, deadline or anything on this. So I don't know if I have to get to it or...
Well, what is it?
That's your summon back to the
manacle,
tower, right?
Apparently. Not exactly. Actually, it's... I gotta go to Vallenberg.
Oh, well. Wear clothes.
I'm guessing this has something to do with the creature that's been attacking them.
Yeah. There's a manacore. But...
Manticore, that's what it is. Oh my goodness.
Manticore. Yeah, there's a specific one. A white one.
So there's gonna be more than one?
Well, probably. I'm supposed to get specifically the white one. Where are we in conjunction with Mount Nact? What? Where to go? I lost sight.
Y'all been moving towards Mount Nact this whole time. You're on the ridge. You're maybe 2 days from the base where you think the stronghold Ustax is.
Is the stronghold at the mount or?
Yeah, it's at the base of the mountain.
Interesting.
So we're basically going that way anyways.
Christoph said Vallenberg was on the other side of the mountain from here.
So, go drop off X. Go kill some flying lion things.
That would seem to be the best course.
Okay. Guess I will get to my cats later. Okay.
So are you staying with us then?
I mean, this is the most interesting things that have been happening to me. And, well, we'll say a while. Anyway, I'm going to go see if I can hunt us some food. Bye. Meli, you want to come?
No, thank you. I'm going to go stand there, Ellory, away from him.
Oh. Okay. Bye. And I'll go try and hunt something. I don't think I'm very good.
Okay. What is Wink trying to hunt?
I guess one of those elk.
Okay, give me a survival check.
Yeah, that's what I'm not great at. 3.
Okay. You go out, you go down the hill there into the forest, start looking around. You do see what looks like tracks of some sort in the snow. They're not super small, but they are deep. You follow them. It seems like you can follow them for a good 5, 10, 15 minutes. And it looks like they continue on. Do you continue to follow them?
No. I think I'm just going to set myself up in a hidey hole and shoot the first animal that crosses in front of me.
Okay. Okay, give me a stealth check.
All right. That is a 23. Or okay. 24, if it's rocky.
It's pretty, yeah, you can find a rocky area as you curl up next to, between two boulders, blending in. And as you're sitting there, you do see kind of a, or you hear a, and you look through the snow. You don't see anything, but you hear where it comes from. And then you see something hop. You see a white-furred rabbit hare. It hops along, stopping every once in a while to sniff into the snow, digging in, trying to find food.
Yeah, sure, that'll do.
Make an attack roll.
Natural one. Oh no, I'm hidden, so 16.
Okay, it strikes into the rabbit and flops a few feet, unmoving. You see its back leg twitches a little bit before slowing down and coming to a stop. You've killed a rabbit.
I'll be very excited about that, and I'll take it back.
Okay. Wink has been gone for a little while, as he was. Before he comes back, were y'all doing anything in particular?
I'm going to do my new thing. If we're just sitting around doing nothing, I'm going to pop a mutagen.
Okay. So over the short rest, which is breakfast, as you're kind of preparing, getting ready to go, rolling hit die if you need to. Kalvyn uses a bit of the fire, draws some blood, begins mixing something of some sort. But over the course, you can indeed make that vial of mutagen. A few minutes later, as you are kind of finishing up, Wink comes back in with a rabbit over his shoulder.
I just kind of hold it up. Great. Does anyone know what to do with this?
I look at Kalvyn.
Huh?
Just wave the dead rabbit in front of you.
Oh, you caught some. Look at that. It's almost as big as you.
Yeah. Do you know how to cook with it? Because I don't have any idea.
How do you survive out here? You don't know how to cook your food.
I mostly just eat berries. Or rocks. Then walk away.
Do you leave the rabbit there?
Oh, yeah, I dropped that on the ground a little bit.
Yeah. Falls on the ground as Wink walks away.
Have we already eaten?
Over the course of you making your mutagen, y'all could have nibbled on some rations, some dried meats.
And I assume we're...
If other people are expecting to eat... Yeah, but I mean, like, do we need it cooked right now? Or are people waiting to eat? Kind of thing? Or are we... All right, we got a rabbit for later.
Kalvyn,
I had some carrots.
Kalvyn, you do remember you have something specifically for this.
Yeah, that's why I was asking. Do I put it in there, or do I hold... Or do we cook it up now? I'm looking every... Y'all hungry still? Y'all need some more food?
I think we can save this for later.
I put it in my bag.
So Kalvyn opens the bag on his back, the satchel. As he opens up, kind of a frosty coolness escapes as he puts the rabbit in there and closes it back up again.
I think while there's like some commotion going on, it all can find an opportunity to kind of go inside for some fresh air.
Yeah. You can go outside.
I'll stay
near sun on your skin.
If he's going outside, I'll stay nearby him.
Okay. You're outside.
I think I'll look for somewhere just to, like, somewhere outside to sit. I don't know if there's, like, a rock or...
Yeah, you can find a rock or a stump or a log or something pretty close nearby.
So I think I'll do that, and then I'll take out the great axe and just kind of set it into the snow beside me. And then just kind of, like, sit there and just... kind of like fidgeting with my holy symbol with my left hand and just kind of staring at the axe and just in like silent thought.
Okay, in contemplation. And Amsen, if you're somewhat nearby, you can probably see him. You're just kind of sitting, looking between the axe and his holy symbol.
While I'm outside, can I just look around the area and listen, I guess, to hear if anything seems to be moving around in the general vicinity?
Yeah, make a perception check.
Okay. That would be a 13.
Listening out, it's fairly quiet around here. The wind isn't too loud. You don't hear anything especially telling.
Then I'll just wait near Ball until he wants to go back inside.
I assume I'm like kind of farther from the party, like I would have.
Could have found the place an appropriate distance away.
I think. I think for now I'll just kind of sit there and still keep contemplating.
I think after about 2 minutes, the Vesper's going to go outside and find him.
Okay, so Vesper, you go over. You see Amsen lock eyes with him, and Amsen kind of nods towards where Ball is. You can see him there sitting on a log 25 feet away, but with an eyesight.
When I get to him, I'm going to speak to him in Giant and just go, well, that was stupid yesterday.
I didn't know where Wink was.
Great, but there was a monster, and we were all trying to get away. We could have found him later.
What if the monster found Wink?
You know, Wink is great. He really is, Bob, but we just met him a few days ago, and we've known each other our entire lives. So I'd hoped that maybe we'd be a bit more of a priority for you.
I thought we all stick together.
We do. And we were leaving. And that's why we came back for you. When you stood there, face to face with a fucking monster, with five heads, and got your ass handed to you.
You're right. I wasn't strong enough.
That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying there's a point where you have to realize that it's time to go. If you want to keep us safe, and I know that's sort of your thing, then you need to come with us and survive so that you can keep us safe tomorrow, and the day after that, and the day after that. And for me especially, it's my job for when you go up against one of these things and get hurt, I'm the one who patches you up. So specifically me, I'm going to be staying there by your side while you're facing certain death. And when it finishes with you, guess who it's going to turn on? The person standing there waiting to pick you back up. So if you want to protect us, you just have to realize when it's time to run.
I'm not like you. I don't know when to run. It's not easy for me to hide.
Then follow my lead. I'm not a fighter. I'm really not. I'm a fucking cleric, and I'm not brave like you. It's true. I'm not. But Bal, you are my brother. You heard me tell you that, right? When we were calling you back. You're my family, and you mean everything to me, and I don't want to watch you get hurt like that again. I don't want to watch you die again.
I'll find a way to be stronger next time. I can't lead a church. I can't sing songs or tell tales. I don't forge steel. I can't wield magic. All I can do is be stronger next time.
And then I think I'll like grip my axe and stand up.
Just be careful too.
I think you'll see like a slight nod from Ball.
Fuck. Just go back in the cave.
Okay.
When she passes me, I'm sitting there playing my lute, and I'm just gonna stop Vesper for a second and just say, because it was all in Giant and I didn't understand anything they said. If you want to talk about it later, just let me know.
I will, thank you.
I'll just nod and keep playing my lute.
I'm going to go inside and sit in a corner and pray.
Yeah. Go ahead.
When Vesper comes in, I'm going to go up to her and say, so, how does he seem?
It's Ball, you know, he's quiet, stoic, blames himself for all of this.
Because obviously him doing what he does means everything is all his fault, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, in this case, it kind of is. He was the only one who didn't run. But he's taken all the responsibility, not that he made a wrong call, but that he wasn't strong enough.
God damn it.
Yeah.
You know, he wasn't the only one who didn't run, though.
Well, kind of.
And I look over at Wink.
Wink had other methods of keeping himself safe.
Which, true. As you have stepped away, Wink is very slowly, like, waving and walking over to Meli. Just like, hi. That's a book in hand. I don't want to spook you, but I was actually hoping you might be able to give me a hand.
Right. With what?
Well, I noticed you seemed good at arcane magic and more of the bookish sort, and I don't really get a chance to talk to many of those. I studied with an elven unit for a little while, and I took some notes, but I've been having trouble making things work. Maybe you can help. I noticed you said you study abjuration. There's a particular thing that I think you can help me out with.
Okay.
So we'll just have minor training montage as Meli helps him decipher some of his old notes.
Really, like, hesitantly and awkwardly, and she's still just gonna, like, stare at him the whole time.
He's trying to talk very slowly, at least for him, and keep his motions very slow and calm. Anyway, sorry. You noticed that as you talk about him.
I said, Meli, you can't help him go over these notes and try to figure out what his notes mean. It takes a little while at first, but eventually you can kind of see the logic there. And start to help him explain what some of the runes mean and how some of the magic is formed. And question at large, did y'all decide to stay here, or are y'all... Is anyone there?
I believe so.
I think that's the plan.
Yeah, I feel like we're staying.
Okay. So we're kind of... The whole day will basically pass by as you guys are... doing whatever you wanted to do. If there was anything you wanted to do specifically while you're basically resting, just let me know.
Yeah, I wanted to do a perimeter check every so often.
Okay, give me a perception check, Kalvyn, as you every periodically just going to do a perimeter check.
Kalvyn, would you like some inspiration?
Technically, I've already rolled.
Ah.
But I rolled a 21. So,
okay. The first couple times, nothing goes by. Bends past noon into 1-2 o'clock as you're doing another round. As you're kind of walking through the snow, you hear something. You hear like the snap of a twig. You kind of sneak behind a tree, kind of look around it just a little bit, and you see what looks like a jaguar type creature. You see it's low to the ground, its shoulders kind of wiry, kind of You can see the broken limb that it stepped on as it's not facing towards you. It's facing upwards towards where the cave is. You see it white fur with periodic black spots over its body.
Interesting. It's heading towards the cave?
Very slowly, very low to the ground, almost dragging its belly across the snow, but it is...
Okay, I would like to pull out one of my swords quietly and pick up a rock and throw it at it.
Make an attack roll with advantages that currently doesn't see you.
Okay, that is What am I adding to it? Like, what kind of, like, it's dexed, right?
A rock, it can be... Rock would really be more of a strength, but I'll say you can use dex or strength as a throw.
I'm all strength. That would be a 21 if it's strength, and not adding a proficiency bonus, because I'm assuming it's not proficient.
Yeah, that still does 1 plus your strength modifier damage, which is...
4 currently, so 5.
Okay. Okay, so you see this cat slowly, and it's a slow-moving target as it's just barely sneaking up and doesn't know you, and you just pick up this rock and you see it hit on the sides of this cat's head as it turns to the side and looks at you with these green eyes, the irises, slits that narrow, and suddenly it disappears. You see a bit of snow that kind of wefts where it once was.
You said, okay, it disappears?
It in a flurry of snow disappears. It's no longer there.
And it had green eyes?
It had like greenish yellow eyes.
Significantly notable green eyes?
Not like, glowing. Okay. Just sort of greenish tinted.
So a magical fucking snow leopard. Am I assuming whoosh, is code for like BAMF and it night crawled out of there? Or
yeah, it just night crawled, like, BAMF, teleported. Whatever term you want to call it, yes.
Okay, that's cool. I don't want to misinterpret, like, oh no, it just does this funky little shake and I get misdirected from the snow. No, that's fine.
That's actually the name of its ability. It casts funky little shake and disappears.
Awesome. Okay, so, well, that's interesting. And he goes running. He goes, yeah, like, I guess calmly. Trying to, with sword still out, but walks, beelines it for the cave.
Okay. You go over, as you're walking, you don't hear any noise around you, nothing descends upon you attacking or anything like that. But you do get back up to the cave where most everyone is kind of hanging around. You see, the rest of you see Kalvyn come with his sword out, his hunting sword.
Everything good, Kalvyn?
Well, depends. Anybody got like some kind of magic snow kitty that's kind of their plaything?
I'm gonna drink my potion right now. Bang.
Go, 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 go. Goes down. It stings. It almost feels like spikes driving into your throat as it comes down. The pain passes though.
Magic snow kitty?
Yeah. There was looked like some kind of leopard or jaguar stalking up on the cave. I got its attention and it just kind of and disappeared.
What? Really?
So sudden.
Wink runs out of the cave.
It's gone, man!
Shit, I follow him out.
It's gone, man!
Wink, where are you going?
Let's all run from the Hydra, but let's go run out there and find this magical kitty. Kitties are the magic words, apparently.
Kalvyn, how many heads did this cat have?
It had these two green yellow eyes that looked into my soul. And right as it disappeared, I knew something was wrong.
Okay, cool. I'm going to follow the others out.
Okay, so Wink leads the way, followed by Ellory and then Vesper as they come running out. Meli and Amsen, Ball, are y'all following or are you just going to hang out?
I will follow, and on my way out, I'm going to put my hand on Calvin's shoulder and be like, good job. That sounded great. And keep going.
Okay. Hey, thanks, man.
Wink leading the way, give me a perception or a survival check, depending if you're just looking or looking for tracks.
They're both terrible, so I'll look for tracks. 19! Ooh!
You run out, and you've watched Kalvyn do the same basic patrol route, and so you follow backwards his patrol route. And as you follow that, you look around and you do see, it's easy to notice as you're looking around and you see color, just a little speckle of red blood. As you move over, you see a rock with a little tiny splutter of red blood on it. You can see a few tracks around it. Definitely quadrupedal, deep tracks. It's at least somewhat heavy with a creature. You can see it had claws. It was definitely not a boot. Probably a feline type creature of some sort.
Let's not go too far, Wink.
All right. I will take measurements of the paw prints in the snow, and I will begrudgingly go inside.
Okay. As you are measuring, the paw is actually pretty significantly sized. And you do notice the tracks move up towards the cave and then suddenly stop. They don't lead anywhere else. They just stop. But it's probably a pretty sizable creature.
All right.
Okay.
I will probably sit at the mouth of the cave and just kind of watch for the rest of the day.
Can we not maybe kind of put our heads together and see what we can maybe think of this thing? Could have summoned it. Anybody?
Maybe this is its cave.
What is it?
A cat that disappears, apparently.
Very astute.
Thank you.
Would I have heard of anything like this? Because I know I was like studying teleportation stuff.
Yeah. Give me a Arcana check.
22.
Okay, Meli. So you all have experienced what the creatures are called catacombs on your way to the tower on the coast of Embershore. But these were more like shifting bobcat-sized creatures. Judging by what Wink has information he may have told you, this is a significantly larger creature. We did learn the catacombs are... Their magical abilities come from another plane of existence, supposedly because they come from the Feywild, or at least are twisted and altered by it. So they're extra planar in nature is why they're able to do this. That's what you learned of the catacombs, and you imagine whatever this creature is, it might be similar. Though it does seem to be significantly bigger than the other creatures you encounter. Perhaps 2 to 3 times bigger.
That kind of sounds like my jam, if that's relayed to the group.
Yep, I will tell everyone.
Yeah, that's that sounds mighty interesting to a little old me. Is there any way to track it? Can we figure out where it went, what it's doing, how it got to us?
Well, it moved to us. I don't know whether we can track it because it can teleport.
Doesn't like there's some sort of magical residual stuff. I don't know.
Would I know if it would leave a? Would I know if it would leave a trace behind that might give a sense of where it's gone?
Theoretically, probably not. But you could, if you knew detect magic, you would try. But it doesn't hold up in theory that well. But it's possible.
Okay.
Well, before we go all arcane on it, why don't we try just, you know, a good old-fashioned snare? If you give me that rabbit, we can try and make a trap for it.
You want to lure it to us?
Yeah. Of course, it can teleport out of a trap, so maybe that wouldn't work either.
To be fair, Kalvyn, you do want to hunt it.
Oh, definitely. I mean, we don't have... No, I don't know what you mean.
I'm saying if it's hard to track, why don't we just bring it to us and then kill it when we can see it?
I can't currently think of any reason why not.
So are y'all going to attempt to create a trap of some sort?
Well, even just set up an ambush, I think, is probably the better way. I mean, we're just sitting here for the rest of the day, right? So... If we want to leave the dead rabbit out there and, I don't know, Ball can put me in a tree and I can
cast alarm on the rabbit as well, so you know if it walks near it.
You know, don't have to go chasing it, but if it comes back before we leave, we can take it out for Kalvyn and then I can examine it.
There were clear tracks now, right? You said you found the tracks.
Yeah, up until it hoofed away.
Well, where... Can you show me those tracks? I mean, I probably know where they are, but, I mean, I don't know. Can I go back to those tracks? Master DM? Maybe.
Yeah, yeah, if Wink shows you where they are. I mean, you could probably find them yourself, but yeah, Wink can show you exactly where they are pretty quickly.
What time of day are we looking at right now?
It's approximately 2-3 o'clock, so you have about 3 hours until nightfall.
Why don't we follow these tracks? Maybe it went back to where it came from.
But hypothetically, if it's a teleporting creature at some point, it's gonna...
All right, Wink, I tell you what, you go back to the cave and here's your rabbit, you go set up your little alarm trap, I'll catch up with y'all later.
Kalvyn.
Well, if you're going after it, I'm not going to not go after it with you. I'm just saying.
That's my boy.
Don't go too far.
Oh, don't you worry, no.
You can say that, but that's not going to stop me from worrying.
Okay, well then you should probably worry a little bit.
I'll keep him safe. You know, or I'll die too.
Yeah, I got Wink. And he slaps him on the back all nice and heartily.
He probably falls.
Come on, let's go.
And he starts following.
So Wink and Kalvyn are leaving to go try to find this creature. The rest of you are staying at the cave, is that right?
Ball will wait outside.
Okay.
I was just going to ask if Ball has come back inside the cave or if he's still out there.
Well, I figured at some point we came back in, but if not, yeah, I figured at some point we came back in because it's been a little bit since the whole Jaguar thing, right? So Ball will just go back outside at this point.
I'll be outside with Ball.
Okay. At the cave, if y'all wanted to do anything, I'll hop back over to you guys in just a second. For those that are going to try and find it, one of you give me a survival check at advantage as you're trying to pick back up the trail.
You should definitely be the one that does that.
Okay, dokey. That is not good. That's an 11.
Okay, so you Wink shows you the tracks and you follow them back. Until they get to about where that open plain is. And once you exit the tree line into that open plain, the tracks suddenly disappear once again.
Do you have advantage because it's a fey creature?
I already had advantage because he was helping me. Is it just, like, it just starts with nothing around it?
It just starts. Yeah, there's nothing around it.
Can we look around the area?
Yeah, are you looking for more tracks?
Not necessarily. I mean, I guess it would be tracks, but I mean, more of a, like, why would it choose to start here? Is there any, like, significant sign of somebody else? Maybe boots? Maybe it was summoned, you know?
I'll say maybe make a nature check.
And can I make an investigation check instead?
Sure.
I mean, my guess is...
Doesn't matter. Any bonus. What?
I guess it was on the other side of the clearing and or somewhere and just wanted to poof to a tree line.
Is there a clearing and another tree line somewhere else?
Across the clearing, there is another tree line.
Interesting. Give me one second. That is terrible. That's an 8. So maybe we should go to that other clearing.
Yeah, looking around, you don't see any more tracks or... any broken branches or any corpse or flesh or anything that was attacked.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but this is where we fled from the five-headed monster yesterday.
That's correct.
Yeah, no, I think I'm just going to go back.
This could be a real threat to the group. We shouldn't just walk away.
It could be, but it teleports, so I don't know how we're going to find it, and I don't want to find the other thing. I do one thing well. Stay alive.
Okay, so let's... I don't understand. Why can't you stay alive while we do this?
You're not going to stay alive. Senses are tingling. Trust me. I'm going to go back. You are welcome to have fun. And he just starts walking back.
Okay, Link starts charging back through the snow, back to the cave.
Kalvyn, how far away is the next tree line?
It's across the large gap. I think I remember it being like 200 feet wide. It's wide. It's substantial. It's like a big football field of just snow.
Well, but football players can run that in seconds. I'm just going to run over there real quick and just see if there's anything in that area. And then and if I don't find anything, I'll come back.
Okay, so you run across the field. Give me another survival check.
I believe in you. I rolled a natural one.
So you run over there, start looking around. You don't immediately see anything. And as Kalvyn is looking around and everyone else is back at the cavern resting up, I'm going to take a quick break and we'll be right back.
Next time on Back to the Story.
Kalvyn, you're hunting a fucking manticore and I'm hearing something growling and flapping around outside.
If you die again, then I take down what killed you, or I die with you.
A tiny little sproutling, two little leaves form out in green, and as you release the magic and kind of watch it, immediately withers and dies into dust.
We are not alone.